some of that sweet, sweet honky-tonk fun. Stand by me. Now the girls all get prettier in town. You don't know me. Well, actually, I dropped out of high school to get married, and I was 16 at the time. It was about a month and a half before I turned 17, and I met this little gal, and we ran away. It's a wonder they hadn't caught us and headed a null, but they didn't, and I had three kids by my first wife. I was married to her 9 years. I came to Houston to do construction work because I couldn't find work there in Louisiana, so I came to work with my father-in-law. I lived in Galena Park at the time. I came through the Washburn Tunnel, came down to Spencer Highway. Of course, Spencer's changed a lot since then because it's gotten so much bigger, and the Pasadena's grown, and the downtown area that used to be Pasadena now is moved out to where we're at the present time. So it's changed a lot since I've been in Pasadena. I've been here since the 50s. I mean, I was here when the only freeway they had was the Gulf Freeway. All these other interchanges and everything wasn't here when I got here. When I was doing construction work, I was trying to go out and play music too. I mean, I was trying to get a break in music at the time. I played 6 nights a week. And I didn't make a lot of money, but I made enough to survive on. And I always felt like that if I could work in the music industry and make a living enough to take care of my family, that I was successful. So I always considered myself successful in music, even though I wasn't making a lot of money. I thought that if I could convince the people to come to this little club that I was gonna play, I felt like there was more people that enjoyed country music, because at the time, the pop and the rock and roll and the blues music was what was selling in Houston. So I felt like if I could get into Pasadena and get a thing going, that I could do some of my cousin's music, Jerry Lee Lewis, because I played piano and I did, you know, songs like A Whole Lot of Shaking, Great Balls of Fire, You Went Again, all these tunes that Jerry Lee had recorded. I thought people would enjoy that kind of music, and sure enough, they did. They liked to hear something a little bit different, and I was different at that time. Goodness gracious, great balls of fire. Kiss me, baby. It was a long struggle. When finally I ended up back in Houston, and I went to work at a place called the Ranch House, which is right there on Spencer Highway, and then a club called the Nessadale, and I worked there for almost 10 years. I went across town, and when I went across town, Sherwood Cryer, who owned the property where the old Gilley's was located at on Spencer Highway, 4500 Spencer Highway, which later became, it was Shelley's then, later became Gilley's. He came over to the Bel Air Ballroom where I was working and convinced me that I need to come back and do a club with him. And so the rest became history. And that was actually the best move I ever made, was coming back and doing the club with him. It was just a metal building with a parachute hanging down the ceiling. It was ridiculous. When Mr. Cryer first came to me and told me he would fix that club up for us to use, first thing I demanded was an acoustical ceiling. I said, we got to have an acoustical ceiling. We can't play music in a tin barn because the sound will bounce around in it. I knew that. And I told him, I said, the floors needed to be tiled. We need some new tables and chairs. He had all those wooden chairs in there. People sat in and ripped the clothes up, you know. I know we opened in 1971, and I know that the club became successful almost immediately. I mean, you know, it was kind of impressive to see, you know, Gilley's on. He took Shelley's off and put Gilley's, and that logo turned out to be a windfall for me. Well, Gilley's was the hottest thing ever in Pasadena. There's no doubt about it. It was party from the time the club opened till the time it closed. It was a big time. There was everything in the world you could do in there. Those cowboys were hitting that punching bag. They were riding the mechanical bull. They were playing all those games we had in there. We must have had 20 to 30 pool tables in there. Every one of them would be playing pool. I mean, it was just an arcade, so to speak. And when the urban cowboy got hot, he couldn't build those mechanical bulls fast enough. He had people begging for them. So Gilley's began to grow, and it became very popular. Our motto was, we doze, but we never close. Of course, we did have to close at 2 o'clock at night, but that was our motto. Me and Mr. Cryer, a lot of times, we would meet after the club and play some pool together. You know, I didn't run home at 2 o'clock, right? Sometimes I'd stay in the club with him and play a bumper pool for an hour and a half. He was very good at that. Sometimes we'd have lunch during the day, discuss the club, discuss what was going on, what we thought we ought to do. If it hadn't been for him, I probably never would have made it in the music business. I always give him credit for it. And even though he's not here now, I admire the fact that he was like a father to me. And in the beginning, we had a very great relationship. After the Urban Cowboy hit was when things started to deteriorate. But up until that time, we had a good working relationship. My business partner, Mr. Cryer, installed the mechanical bull. And through his endeavors of the mechanical bull, this guy came down and wrote the article, you know, The Ballad of the Urban Cowboy. And I thought I thought the article was kind of bad because it kind of made fun of country music, you know, boy meets girl, twang, twang. Boy falls in love with a girl, twang, twang. And I said, this article sucks. And he said, we're going out to California to do an interview with, it was either Mike Douglas or Merv Griffin or Dinah Shore, one of those talk shows. And he says, don't say anything about that show because we might get a movie out of that article. And I said, what side of the bed did you fall off on? He says, no, he said, they're thinking about getting John Travolta to do it. I said, John Travolta, Saturday Night Fever, Country Night Fever. I didn't open my mouth anymore about that article. I loved it. Gilley's was so well known. After the Urban Cowboy hit, I mean, everybody, if you didn't play Gilley's, who were you? You can't think of any other act that came through that didn't want to play the club. It was a thing to do to put on every, you know, hey, we played Gilley's. The only two people I know that didn't play the club that was big was Dolly Parton and Kenny Rogers. Alabama played it. Waylon Jennings played it. Willie Nelson played it. Me and Johnny played it. At one time during the Urban Cowboy, me and Johnny Lee was the hottest act in country music. But it was very important to him to play Gilley's Nightclub because Gilley's was so popular with the Urban Cowboy. If it's good for John Travolta, it was good for everybody. She came out with a girlfriend to the Nessadale, and I had just had heart surgery at that time, and she looked at me and thought I was a sort of a ghost almost. She said, boy, I look terrible, you know. And at first, I was just infatuated with her, you know. And I went over, and I'd come over and sit and talk to her, and I couldn't remember her name, Vivian. I wanted to call her Virginia. I knew it started with a V, but I could not remember Vivian, you know. And so that went on for quite some time. Finally, I wrote it down, put it on my piano, so when they came in, I remember what her name was. There was no lap of luxury when she first met me. I was working, and she was working downtown Houston, and it took all the money that we could scrape together to just pay my child support. So it had to be love, because it definitely was not a luxury item to be tied with MG. In about 3 months in the operation of the Gilley's Club, I got a local TV show sponsored by Furniture Outlet at the time. About the same thing that Gallery Furniture is doing now, you know, except that I was a spokesperson and I did a TV show for them. And I was the lead-in for all the country music performers there on Channel 39. And then the show was shown a little bit on Channel 11, too. And the show became popular because people would tune in to see what the heck was going on, you know, because I didn't know what I was doing. But I was trying to produce it and write it and perform it and the whole bit, you know. If I sent a rose with me, every time that I cried all night, you'd have a room full of roses. After I had Room Full of Roses hit back in 74, I started trying to have hit records, and I had four number one songs right in a row. And the money was coming in, like you turn on a water faucet just about, because the club was doing well. I had had, four or five, maybe six number one country music songs. I was traveling with Conway and Loretta on the road. Money was coming in, both from the club and to my road work. So we had more money than we actually was used to spending. So then when we decided that we would move up in the world is when the Urban Cowboy hit, then it really turned around. I went from working for $6,000 and $7,000 a night to anywhere from $25,000 to $50,000 a night. So when you get that kind of money, you know, I bought an airplane, I bought a prop jet, I had a jet, I had two buses, I had an 18-wheeler. We built this home out here where we're sitting at right now on this 22 acres. We own this. I did quite well for a long period of time there. I got almost 10,000 square feet over there. What person in their lifetime needs that kind of a home? You don't. You know, we live out of about three rooms in that house. And we got a five-car garage. So, you know, it just don't make sense. And most of them are parked on the portage. So it don't make sense that you'd do something that, you know, that wild and crazy. I've never felt isolated, and I've never looked at myself as being a star. I don't like the word star. I think of myself as a performer. I enjoy the music. I enjoy the people. I enjoy the camaraderie that I have with the fans. I never try to shun anybody. I try to sign the autographs they ask me to sign. I take pictures with them. I do everything that I can to let them know that I am a very personable person, that I want to be the boy next door, and that's what it amounts to. Only time I had a problem in the Houston area was when we had Astro tickets, and we'd go to the Astrodome to watch the Astros play. And I quit going because a lot of people would recognize the fact that I was there, and they would interrupt the other people in the audience by coming down and wanting me to sign something for them. And so I quit going to the games because of that. Later, it wasn't as prevalent as it was, because it was at the end of the urban, the urban cowboy craze is what boomed everything. And people would recognize the fact I was in the audience. They'd want to come down and talk to me. So I disturbed the people around the seats that we had. I had four seats there. We had season tickets. So eventually I told the wife, I said, you know, I'd love to go to the game, but I think I'll just sit home and watch it on TV. When I fell and hurt myself 2.5 years ago, I was doing five shows a week in my theater. I was flying back and forth, my airplane, and when I fell and hurt myself and almost killed myself, it changed my life totally, because I can't do the things I'd like to do. I used to come home and mow the grass out here, help my yard man mow and work on the property, which I enjoyed. I enjoyed doing that. I enjoyed doing things around the house, fixing things, fixing lights. Something breaks, get it fixed. Things like that. Just as long as you stand by me. Because I still like to play. I still like to get up, you know, and perform the songs. Even though my piano playing hands are not working right at the present time, my vocals are probably better than they've ever been. I get a lot of compliments on my performance in Branson, so I'm going to take their word that I'm performing singing-wise. I said, well, one thing, I'm not having to concentrate on playing the piano since I can't play it, so I can concentrate more on my vocals. Stand by me. Won't you stand by me? Do it see. I got a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame, which was a very entertaining and interesting time in mine and her life, because she was out there with me. I also got to play for President Reagan at the White House. I got to play for President Bush. I've been all over the world. The years went too fast, but other than that, I've had a good life. I tell everybody, if I drop tomorrow, it's been a good ride. I've accomplished a lot.